This program contains a PDF of reference materials. Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Undoing Project, A Friendship That Changed Our Minds, by Michael Lewis, read by Dennis Boutsikaris.
For Dacher Keltner, my chief jungle guide. Doubt is not a pleasant condition, but certainty is an absurd one. Voltaire. Introduction. The problem that never goes away. Back in 2003, I published a book called Moneyball about the Oakland Athletics' quest to find new and better ways to value baseball players and evaluate baseball strategies. The team had less money to spend on players than other teams, and so its management, out of necessity, set about rethinking the game. In both new and old baseball data, and the work of people outside the game who had analyzed that data, the Oakland front office discovered what amounted to new baseball knowledge. That knowledge allowed them to run circles around the managements of other baseball teams. They found value in players who had been discarded or overlooked, and folly in much of what passed for baseball wisdom. When the book appeared, some baseball experts, entrenched management, talent scouts, journalists, were upset and dismissive, but a lot of readers found the story as interesting as I had. A lot of people saw in Oakland's approach to building a baseball team a more general lesson. If the highly paid, publicly scrutinized employees of a business that had existed since the 1860s could be misunderstood by their market, who couldn't be? If the market for baseball players was inefficient, what market couldn't be? If a fresh analytical approach had led to the discovery of new knowledge in baseball, was there any sphere of human activity in which it might not do the same? In the past decade or so, a lot of people have taken the Oakland A's as their role model and set out to use better data and better analysis of that data to find market inefficiencies. I've read articles about Moneyball for education, Moneyball for movie studios, Moneyball for Medicare, Moneyball for golf, Moneyball for farming, Moneyball for book publishing, Moneyball for presidential campaigns, Moneyball for government, Moneyball for bankers, and so on. All of a sudden, we're Moneyballing offensive linemen, an offensive line coach for the New York Jets complained in 2012. After seeing the diabolically clever data-based approach taken by the North Carolina legislature in writing laws to make it more difficult for African Americans to vote, the comedian John Oliver congratulated the legislators for having Moneyballed racism. But the enthusiasm for replacing old-school expertise with new-school data analysis was often shallow. When the data-driven approach to high-stakes decision-making did not lead to immediate success, and occasionally even when it did, it was open to attack in a way that the old approach to decision-making was not. In 2004, after aping Oakland's approach to baseball decision-making, the Boston Red Sox won their first World Series in nearly a century. Using the same methods, they won it again in 2007 and 2013. But in 2016, after three disappointing seasons, they announced that they were moving away from the data-based approach and back to one where they relied upon the judgment of baseball experts. "We have perhaps overly relied on numbers," said owner John Henry. The writer Nate Silver for several years enjoyed breathtaking success predicting U.S. presidential election outcomes for the New York Times, using an approach to statistics he learned writing about baseball. For the first time in memory, a newspaper seemed to have an edge in calling elections. But then Silver left the Times and failed to predict the rise of Donald Trump, and his data-driven approach to predicting elections was called into question by the New York Times. "Nothing exceeds the value of shoe leather reporting, given that politics is an essentially human endeavor and therefore can defy prediction and reason," wrote a Times columnist late in the spring of 2016. Never mind that few shoe-leather reporters saw Trump coming, either, or that Silver later admitted that, because Trump seemed sui generis. He'd allowed an unusual amount of subjectivity to creep into his forecasts. I'm sure some of the criticism of people who claim to be using data to find knowledge and to exploit inefficiencies in their industries has some truth to it. But whatever it is in the human psyche that the Oakland A's exploited for profit, this hunger for an expert who knows things with certainty, even when certainty is not possible, has a talent for hanging around. It's like a movie monster that's meant to have been killed, but is somehow always alive for the final act. And so, once the dust had settled on the responses to my book, one of them remained more alive and relevant than the others, a review by a pair of academics, then both at the University of Chicago, an economist named Richard Thaler and a law professor named Cass Sunstein. Thaler and Sunstein's piece, which appeared on August 31, 2003 in The New Republic, managed to be at once both generous and damning. The reviewers agreed that it was interesting that any market for professional athletes might be so screwed up that a poor team like the Oakland A's could beat most rich teams simply by exploiting the inefficiencies. But they went on to say, the author of Moneyball did not seem to realize the deeper reason for the inefficiencies in the market for baseball players. They sprang directly from the inner workings of the human mind. The ways in which some baseball expert might misjudge baseball players, the ways in which any expert's judgments might be warped by the expert's own mind, had been described years ago by a pair of Israeli psychologists, Daniel Kahneman and Amos Tversky. My book wasn't original. It was simply an illustration of ideas that had been floating around for decades and had yet to be fully appreciated by, among others, me. That was an understatement. Until that moment, I don't believe I'd ever heard of either Kahneman or Tversky, even though one of them had somehow managed to win a Nobel Prize in economics. And I hadn't actually thought much about the psychological aspects of the Moneyball story. The market for baseball players was rife with inefficiencies? Why? The Oakland front office had talked about biases in the marketplace. Foot speed was overrated because it was so easy to see, for instance, and a hitter's ability to draw walks was undervalued in part because walks were so forgettable. They seemed to require the hitter mainly to do nothing at all. Fat or misshapen players were more likely to be undervalued. Handsome, fit players were more likely to be overvalued. All of these biases that the Oakland front office talked about I'd found interesting, but I hadn't really pushed further and asked, where do the biases come from? Why do people have them? I'd set out to tell a story about the way markets worked or failed to work, especially when they were valuing people. But buried somewhere inside it was another story, one that I'd left unexplored and untold, about the way the human mind worked or failed to work when it was forming judgments and making decisions. When faced with uncertainty about investments or people or anything else, how did it arrive at its conclusions? How did it process evidence from a baseball game, an earnings report, a trial, a medical examination, or a speed date? What were people's minds doing, even the minds of supposed experts, that led them to the misjudgments that could be exploited for profit by others, who ignored the experts and relied on data? And how did a pair of Israeli psychologists come to have so much to say about these matters that they more or less anticipated a book about American baseball written decades in the future? What possessed two guys in the Middle East to sit down and figure out what the mind was doing when it tried to judge a baseball player or an investment or a presidential candidate? And how on earth does a psychologist win a Nobel Prize in economics? In the answers to those questions, it emerged there was another story to tell. Here it is. Chapter 1. Man Boobs. You never knew what a kid in the interview room might say to jolt you out of your slumber and back to your senses and force you to pay attention. And once you were paying attention, you naturally placed far greater weight on whatever he had just said than you probably should. The most memorable moments in job interviews for the National Basketball Association were hard to consign to some appropriately sized compartment in the brain. In certain cases, it was as if the players were trying to screw up your ability to judge them. For instance, when the Houston Rockets interviewer asked one player if he could pass a drug test, the guy had gone wide-eyed and grabbed the table and said, "You mean today?" There was the college player who'd been arrested on charges, subsequently dropped, of domestic violence, and whose agent claimed it had been a simple misunderstanding. When they'd asked the player about it, he'd explained, chillingly, that he'd grown weary of his girlfriend's bitching, so I just put my hands around her neck and I squeezed because I needed her to shut up. There was Kenneth Faried, the power forward out of Morehead State. When he showed up for his interview, they'd asked him, "Do you prefer to be called Kenneth or Kenny?" "Manimal," Faried said. He wanted to be called Manimal. What did you do with that? Roughly 3 out of every 4 of the black American players who came for NBA interviews, or at least came for interviews with the NBA's Houston Rockets, had never really known their father. It's not uncommon when you ask these guys who their biggest male influence was for them to say, "My mom," said the Rockets' director of player personnel, Jimmy Paulus. One said Obama. Then there was Sean Williams. Back in 2007, Sean Williams, 6'10", was an off-the-charts player who had been suspended from his Boston College team the first 2 of his 3 seasons after being arrested for possession of marijuana, a charge that was later dropped. He'd played only 15 games his sophomore year and still blocked 75 shots. The fans referred to his college games as the Sean Williams block party. Sean Williams looked like a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.